Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Welcome in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Worship today on this third Sunday of Easter draws our hearts and minds around our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, who has brought life and immortality to light. We hear in the gospel lesson of how Jesus once again comes into the midst of his frightened, uncertain disciples, assuring them that he is risen. He is risen indeed. So I invite you to join your heart and voice in today's service, whether you are here in person or joining us online via live streaming. May our risen Lord Jesus Christ bless this time of worship. We begin now with the rite of confession and absolution that's found in your worship bulletin. I invite you to stand as you are able. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
I invite you to kneel or be seated for confession. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends in Christ, thus assured of God's rich mercy in the death and resurrection of our Savior Jesus, let's stand and join our hearts and voices in the processional hymn. It is found in that Burgundy Hymnal, Lutheran Service Book, number 477. Alleluia, alleluia, hearts to heaven. Please face the processional cross as it leads us in worship.
Thank you.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Perpetual gladness and eternal joys. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. I invite children in the congregation to come forward and gather here on the chancel steps for a message. Miss Jennifer is away today. She is down in Williamsburg for the district youth gathering, so I'm going to lead the message. I'm glad you're here today. Hello, everybody. Come on up. Drake and Porter, good to see you guys. All right, we're going to start off by playing a game called Name That Food. And here it is. You want to see what it is? Okay, you got to tell me what it is. What do you think it is? Is it a fruit? Is it a vegetable? Oh, Jalea, you are on it. What do you think it is? You are right. I'm impressed. I thought they would be stumped for sure. Aaliyah, you were the first one to say it. Stand up. Name that food. That food is salmon. You're looking at what Pastor Meehan ate for dinner last night right here. So we won't be eating this for lunch because it's been out of the refrigerator a long time. So you can prepare salmon or any kind of fish lots of different ways. Anybody like to eat fish? Yeah? You like to eat salmon? Okay, all right. So you know what? We're gonna hear in the gospel lesson for today how Jesus ate fish. That's right. After he gave his life on the cross, after he rose from the dead, he appeared to his disciples. They were all together, they were scared, they were uncertain, they didn't know what was really going on yet. And Jesus came into the midst of them, and he did something to show that it really was Jesus, their Lord, their Master. You know what he did? Yes, he let them touch him, but he also said, "Do you have anything to eat here?" And you know what they had to eat? Not salmon. We don't know what kind of fish, but they had some broiled fish. Maybe it was salmon, but maybe it was another kind of fish. And Jesus took it, and he ate it right in front of them. Well, that's not what a ghost does. Jesus had to prove that he wasn't just some ghost. He was the real Jesus. And Hazel, what you said before, I'm going to ask Sophie and Grace to come out here. They're carrying, look who they've got. Okay, so this is a cutout of Jesus. And how did they know it was really Jesus? What did you say, Hazel? You are right, Matthew. Okay, what do we see right here on Jesus? Oh, Sophie, you're hidden behind Jesus here. What do we got in Jesus' hands? Can you see the marks where the nails were that were in his hands? And this is how they knew it was really Jesus, because he showed them the scars, the wounds, where he had been nailed to the cross, and they knew it was Jesus then. And although our eyes can't, like those first disciples, see Jesus, we know by faith that he is among us here and now. He says where two or three people are gathered together in his name, he's present among them. Do we have two or three people here today? Much more than that. And so we're trusting and believing and knowing that the risen Jesus is among us here and now. And he's coming to us. He might not eat that piece of broiled fish today, but he's among us in his word, the scriptures. He's among us in the supper that he's prepared of Holy Communion. So we want to say, thank you, Jesus. You are alive and present among us. Thank you. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Thank Jesus. Dear Jesus, we thank you for your Easter victory. You are alive. You are risen from the dead. You are among us here and now, just like you were with your first disciples. Help us to know and trust that you are with us always. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. Thank you, Grace and Sophie. And thank you for coming up, boys and girls. You can go back and be seated. And we will continue with the scripture readings appointed for today, the third Sunday of Easter.
First reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 3. While the lame man, who was now healed, clung to Peter and John, all the people ran together to them in the portico called Solomon's, astounded. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. But you denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked for a murderer to be granted to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And his name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given the man this perfect health in the presence of you all. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer, he thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn again, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring of all things about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago. This is the word of the Lord. Our psalm is Psalm 4, which we will read responsibly. Answer me when I call, O God of my righteousness. You have given me relief when I was in distress. Be gracious to me and hear my prayer. But know that the Lord has set apart the godly for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him.
Be angry, not sin. Ponder in your own hearts on your beds, and be silent.
Offer right sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord. Our many be saved.
Who will show us some good? Lift up the light of your face upon us.
You have put more joy in my heart than they have when their grain and wine abound.
In peace I will both lie down and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety.
The epistle reading is from the book of 1 John, chapter 3. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous as he is righteous. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel preceded by the Alleluia and verse.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 24th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As the disciples were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The message for today, this third Sunday of Easter, rises up out of that gospel reading read just now from Luke chapter 24. Please be seated. So Jennifer Hills, our director of discipleship, and I were away for part of this past week attending the District Church Workers Conference in Asheville, North Carolina. It was a great conference. Some are better than others, but this one was particularly good. We had the major presenter was a district president from Texas, another pastor from California presented also, and it was all about care of church workers, how we are taking care of ourselves, and it was just a blessing. We were at this amazing facility called Ridgecrest outside of Asheville, an amazing facility, and we were just richly blessed. A good balance of learning and rest and relaxation, and just give thanks to God for all of the blessings received in this past week. So, you know, the truth is, whenever we are engaged in discussion with other people, it's always a good idea to keep an open mind, right? We might actually learn something. There's a Latin phrase that sums this up very well. Audi alterum partem. Let the other side be heard. And I believe this is especially relevant as our congregation prepares for a pivotal voters' meeting 2 weeks from today on Sunday, April 28th. 2 weeks from today, we will consider proposed renovations and some expansion for our church facilities, as these have all been shared with the congregation at the four recent town hall meetings, as well as additional meetings that have been held with various groups. And through these meetings, all of them, different viewpoints, different perspectives, different concerns have been raised. And I want to do a shout out to our congregational leadership, our campus projects team, our church council, who have done yeoman's work to keep and maintain an open mind to let all sides be heard. And now, in these days leading up to that voters' meeting on April 28th, we are in prayerful discernment about what the Lord would have us do. As we pray together that petition of the Lord's Prayer, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." This decision that we will be considering is not one that we enter into lightly or easily, but we do so with an open mind, trusting that through the leading and through the guiding of the Holy Spirit, the Lord will make clear the pathway forward, and that the Lord will also provide what is needed for the way ahead. The Lord asks nothing of his people without first providing the necessary means to accomplish what he would have done. And so all of that by way of introduction to today's gospel lesson. The risen Christ appears again to his disciples. He showed them his hands and feet, the wounds of his crucifixion. Jesus made clear then that he was not some disembodied spirit, but that he had flesh and bones, even in his resurrected body. And he then ate a piece of broiled fish. And having done so, he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And so the message for this day, based on these words from the gospel lesson, is entitled, "An Open Mind." May the Lord's rich and abundant blessing rest upon the preaching, the hearing, and the living of his word for Jesus' sake. You know, I marvel at the physicality of Jesus' resurrection. The physical body of Jesus, the Word made flesh, born of Mary, remains. It's intact even after he is risen from the dead. There is no decay. There is no decomposition that we normally associate with death. His disciples were able to see him with their own eyes. They were able to feel and touch his body, even the terrible scars of his suffering and death upon the cross. Still visible in his glorified body, it is through these blessed wounds of Jesus that the disciples know beyond the shadow of a doubt that it is truly, really, their beloved Lord and Master. Jesus even partakes of some food, eating that piece of broiled fish, as we heard. All of these indicate that the physical body of Jesus was still intact, and that after he ate that broiled fish there, the disciples' minds must have been really turned inside out and upside down with all of this. And so, Jesus honors what God first created, Adam out of dust, forming Eve from Adam out of his own flesh. And we also are flesh and blood, physical human beings. We believe that like our risen Savior, even when we die, there will be a resurrection of our mortal bodies, like we confess in the Creed. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. The physical nature of our bodies will remain. But in that new creation, these will give way to something which really defies description, goes beyond imagination, as God's word tells us. Our citizenship is in heaven, And from it, we await a Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him to subject all things to himself. Friends, that is the power of our Easter hope. All this is received by faith. Logic, reason tell us that dead is dead. But faith looks to Jesus, who is risen from the dead, who lives and reigns to all eternity. Today's epistle lesson from 1 John reminds us of the close connection between the risen Savior and his disciples. Beloved, we are God's children now. And what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. Did you catch that? Not only will we see him, but we're going to be like him. Jesus' glorious resurrection body will be ours as well. So here is a call for us to keep that opened mind, that heart of faith, in the midst of all of the frustrations, all of the failings that we now experience with our own bodies. Our bodies not looking the way we would like them to look. Our bodies not doing the things that we would like them to do. Our bodies no longer functioning the way we want them to. Jesus promises that we shall be like him when he appears. How great is that? But wait! There's more. After appearing to his disciples and eating that piece of broiled fish, Jesus goes on to explain that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. And Jesus here is referring to the totality of the Hebrew scriptures, Tanakh, as it is often called. Tanakh is an acronym based on the three divisions of the Hebrew scriptures: Torah, the law of Moses, Nevi'im, the prophets, and Ketuvim, the writings, Psalms, Proverbs, etc. And at the center of all of the scriptures is the crucified and risen Lord Jesus Christ. It all points to him. It has all been gloriously fulfilled in him. And as Jesus opened the minds of his disciples to receive this, so he must open our minds to receive this as well. Human logic, human reason will come up with a whole laundry list of criticisms and critiques why this cannot be. And it must be said that we do possess the terrible power within us to close our minds, to shut them down, to keep out the light and life of the risen Christ. God forbid that we should turn in on ourselves, shutting out the risen Christ, closing our minds to him. Will we give the risen Lord Jesus Christ permission to enter into our minds and hearts so that he might open them to his saving love? And in opening the minds of his disciples then and now, Jesus makes clear that all of the scriptures testifies to his suffering and death and resurrection. And we might say, yeah, but what's the reason behind all of this? What's it for? What's the purpose of Jesus'
suffering and death and resurrection. And Jesus provides that as well. So that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in Jesus' name to all nations beginning from Jerusalem. And friends in Christ, this is why we do what we do. This is what the church is all about, proclaiming Jesus to people everywhere so that all nations and tribes and peoples and languages may come to that about face, that turnaround, that change of heart and mind that is spirit-given repentance, which leads to forgiveness of sins, restoration, blessed assurance, peace which passes all understanding through what Jesus has done. The message remains the same from generation to generation. That message may be packaged a little bit differently from time to time, but the content remains unchanged. It's all about Jesus and what he has done for us. You are witnesses of these things. Jesus' words here were originally spoken to his first disciples, but Jesus is speaking these same words to us today, to his children of every time and place. He is speaking these words to us here and now. You are witnesses of these things. And so what we have learned through our friend Greg Finke joining Jesus on his mission, the five mission practices, their attending questions, all of this is extremely relevant. We see ourselves as everyday witnesses, everyday missionaries in all the places where God has placed us. We're striving to see what Jesus is doing out there ahead of us in the mission field of our homes and our neighborhoods, our schools and places of work and leisure, wherever we might be. We're looking for the opportunities that Jesus is presenting to us. We are willing to walk through the doors that Jesus is opening up to us. We are keeping an open mind to what Jesus would have us learn and do. Jesus' cautionary words to his first disciples about staying in the city until being clothed with power from on high, that was the first Pentecost. With the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We are Pentecost people. We live this side of that event. Through our baptism into Christ's death and resurrection, we have been clothed with power from on high through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. We are witnesses of these things. Rejoicing in our risen Savior with open minds, with open hearts, we go forth to be his witnesses. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Amen. And the God of peace himself sanctify you wholly, your spirit, your soul, and your body. Be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. Amen. I invite you now to join in singing the hymn of the day. It's found in that little blue hymnal supplement with one voice, hymn number 671. Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks. Let's stand to sing.
all boldness and confidence profess the faith we share in the words of the Nicene Creed printed in your worship bulletin. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. Rejoicing with all the witnesses of the resurrection, let us pray in confidence for the church, the world, and all who are in need. We pray for God's wisdom and guidance upon our upcoming congregational voters meeting in 2 weeks' time on Sunday, April 28th. And we ask for safe travels and God's blessings on youth and adult leaders in Williamsburg this weekend attending the district junior high youth gathering. For the bereaved, we pray for Cynthia, wife of Andrew, and family at the death of her mother last month. For those in need of healing, we pray for Jurgen, the husband of Susan, undergoing back surgery on Tuesday of this week, April 16th. And for Jana, daughter of Greer and Nyla, recovering from brain surgery last week on April 8th. Praying also for Katerina, the sister of Angela, hospitalized with various health and leg issues. In this Easter season, each of our prayers ends with the words, "Hear us, O God." We respond by saying, "Your mercy is great." I invite you to kneel or be seated to pray.
Lord Jesus Christ, the light of your love shines on illuminating the places where you are present. As the bewildered disciples pondered the stories of your appearance, you penetrated the darkness of their fear and doubt with your word of peace. You showed them the marks of evil pierced on your hands and feet. You opened their minds to understand why you had to die to defeat such evil and death. Increase our understanding, we pray, and open our minds and hearts to receive you. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Creator Lord, we pray for the world you made, thanking you for the signs of new life and hope. We praise you for our country, its beauty, the riches it has for us, and the gift it showers on us. We thank you for your people, the gift of languages we speak, the variety of races we have, the cultural heritage we cherish. Grant that we accept these gifts with thankfulness and use them for the good of the human race and bring glory to you. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Merciful Lord, amidst our Easter joy, we ask for your loving compassion on all whose lives have been marred by tragedy of any kind. Look with mercy on those who are living in war-torn countries, those who are injured, those who are fleeing from danger, those who are homeless, those who are hungry, those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Bless those who work to bring them relief. Inspire generosity and compassion in all our hearts. Help us to believe that all things are possible, that nations can make peace, that men and women can love their enemies, that justice can prevail. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. Heavenly Father, by the incarnation of your Son, the reconciliation of his cross, you have made us your children and gathered us into your holy church. Sustain the preaching and teaching of your word and its message of repentance for the forgiveness of sins in Jesus' name, that is for all the nations of the world. By the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to bear witness to our risen Savior through our words and deeds. Hear us, O God. Give peace, O Lord, to our homes and enliven them by the power of your Son's resurrected life. Let the forgiveness of sins reign among us and uphold us all by your right hand. Give safety to all travelers and bestow wisdom and guidance upon all who need it, including our congregation, as we come together for our voters' meeting in 2 weeks' time. Hear us, O God. Almighty God, preserve our nation and its leaders. Preserve order and decency in this fallen world by their hands, and restrain every evil plan and purpose, that we may look not only to our own interests, but to the interest of others, especially those who are in any need or distress. Hear us, O God. God of all comfort, you have compassion on those who are afflicted. Remember and have mercy on all the sick and suffering, the grieving and sorrowful, those bearing heavy burdens, and all those in need of your healing and deliverance. Praying especially for Cynthia and family at the death of her mother, for Jurgen, Jana, Katerina, and all who are in need of your healing power. Hear us, O God. Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, by your Son's crucifixion, all our sins have been blotted out. And by his glorious resurrection, you have assured us of eternal life in him. Send us now the blessed refreshment of his presence in the sacrament of the altar, and make us fit partakers of this holy supper. Hear us, O God. In resurrection hope, we commend to you all for whom we pray, trusting in the promise of new life through Jesus Christ, our risen Savior. Amen. Please stand. I invite you to share the peace we have in Christ with one another. Please be seated. Welcome to each of you this morning, those who are here present in person, those joining us online via live streaming. May our faith in our risen Savior be strengthened through this time of worship this morning. For those who are present in person, please take a moment, fill out a connection card that's in the pew rack in front of you. You can leave that in the offering plate that's located in the back of our sanctuary. For anyone who is a first-time guest among us, we bid you special welcome in Jesus' name. You may request information about St. John's and its ministry from our ushers as you leave the service this morning. On that connection card, please note on the back of it is a space where you may write prayer requests. These are then channeled to our congregation's prayer team, and they are kept in prayer. Note also on the front of the card, if you intend to come to the Lord's Supper, please circle names on the front of the card as well. At the back of the worship bulletin is information about online giving with the QR code that will take you to a secure portal of our church's website. Thank you for your faithfulness and generosity in supporting what the Lord's doing among us here at St. John's. I want to say thank you to Lois Lehrer, who is serving as our guest organist today. David Lehay, our director of music, is away this weekend, and so we thank Lois for leading us in song and in music. Note that the playground renovation is still underway. Much work was done this past week. If you haven't had opportunity to go take a look at that, please do so. Lots of new equipment has been installed already, and God willing, the work should be done by the end of this week. Next Friday is our goal, and so weather permitting, that's what we hope for. It will be a solid addition for our congregation's ministry, and particularly that of our Early Childhood Education Center. Go and take a look at that. Again, a reminder, we want as many voting members here present 2 weeks from today, Sunday, April 28th, for that very important voters meeting to consider the proposed renovations and expansion to our church facilities here. An email with more detailed information will be coming out in the next day or two from Denise, our congregational president, so please be watching for that. And lastly, I want to share with you, if you haven't signed up for our church app, this was way back in January, February when we were doing Being SJLC, but it still applies. This is a wonderful resource to receive communications, updates, informations, to contribute financially, all sorts of things, to sign up for Bible studies, whatever. So all the information is there. And so you can take a picture of it now from where you are if you haven't done this. But please do take advantage of it. It really is like every other app we have on our smartphones, an aid that makes things happen. And so, everything else for the week ahead, you will find in the midweek update that comes out each Wednesday morning at 10 a.m. And now, as we have brought our gifts, whether electronically or in person, we present them to the Lord for his kingdom purposes in the offertory prayer printed in your worship bulletin. Please stand.
Let us pray. Blessed are you,
O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you have raised us to new life in Christ, give us glad and generous hearts, ready to praise you and to respond to those in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and ever-living God. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of our Lord. For he is the true Passover Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter, and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending Savior. With repentant joy we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Please stand for the close of the service. Now may this true body and blood of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. We join in singing the post-communion canticle printed in your worship bulletin. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for the resurrection of your beloved Son, Jesus, our Savior. Fill us with his endless life and light on our journey of faith. Bless those who go forth to carry the sacrament to the sick and homebound of our congregation. Let the gifts of Christ's body and blood in the sacrament bring your gifts of forgiveness, life, and salvation to all who receive them. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen. Receive now the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you. We join in our recessional hymn number 480 in Lutheran service book, He's Risen, He's Risen.